We're building a wild pool system on the top floor of a house, 24 feet deep in the water. We're doing all kinds of fun things, some waterfalls, wet walls. Catch up on the old stuff, follow the new. We love you guys. Back to work.
It's physics, math, and engineering. Machine it, draft it, build it, test it, break it. Every time something new gets built, the entire world advances. Laying in bed at night, it's designing new parts, designing new suspension, designing new wings.
All right, guys, we are getting so close finishing up this house. We're into the landscaping phase. It's been back and forth landscaping for a while now. I'm just finishing up this block wall. You can see where we got these corners cut. Sometimes a lot of people just chop the edge. It's worth spending a little more time beveling all the sides, even on a cut edge. It helps it make it look a little more factory cut. This mesh right here, the GeoGrid, it's not a very tall wall. A lot of guys won't start using this till they get 3 or 4 feet. I really don't like to do that where we get the winter freeze, where moisture will get into the soil, freeze and try and push the wall outward, and each year that wall works out, dirt falls in and doesn't go back. So I like to GeoGrid back. This thing's all tied back, concreted base. And now this is two blocks from the top. So this is the last layer of GeoGrid. This soil has been completely compacted already. We'll glue this in between the next two layers of blocks. That will give 8 inches of soil on top of this last layer of GeoGrid. Lock this wall back so we don't have heave and movement in the winter. It caught me. I feel really good about it. We're getting close. The rest of these blocks are gonna go super fast. We're on top, only a few cuts to do. You guys know the drill. Back to work. Got our Ashlyn. An operator. She runs this rig really well and the Bobcat, little Skitty. Working on setting the trees and bushes in the front yard. Getting ready to plant everything out. About to work. All right, we're laying out the trees. Starting to plant a few of them. Got a bunch more right there. Got a bunch of back-breaking awesome workers going at it. All right, guys, we're working on closing in the two underground water vaults that are in the basement. One's for the hot tub, one's for the pool. It's where all the water drains to for the filters, the skimming baskets, and if the power went out, so the entire pool and all the water line drain so it can't freeze. However, there's so much moisture in the basement. If I didn't cover those giant water vaults, especially the hot tub one that's gonna be 104 degrees, it would just steam up that whole area of the basement and everything would become near 100% humidity and everything would rust and would just be a mess. So I've got to make a nearly watertight, at least to stop all of the moisture from getting into the air, and put a Lexan top on it. So I have my son Dylan make this up. It's a quick, simple trick. It would be hard to make this really crazy shape that's going around the round swimming pool in that water vault. So we just use sticks, some hot glue, quick cuts, build it down there, bring it upstairs and cut it. So my son just did this, traced it. Now we just cut out this shape and it'll drop right in. You guys know the drill. Get back to work. Good job, Dylan. That's really slow.
Most oddly satisfying part. Got both sides done. Can't even hardly see it.
Okay, guys, I'm getting all the vault done. This is the giant skimmer basket that my son built, and Dylan did this. Good job, Dylan. And then these pipes right here are all coming down from the 6 skimmers on the pool. So I've got 2 of these done. I've got a couple more here, a couple more over there. They're going into different areas of the vault. But basically, the water gravity feeds off the backside of the skimmers where I made those big stainless steel custom skimmer tops. All that water free flows down here, and all the pipes when it went in got bigger and they make no connection to each other anywhere along the way. So there's nowhere for anything to hang up. So if you can stick a tennis ball in through the skimmer,
it opens up larger and it can find its way all the way down and end up in this basket. So leaves, debris, everything goes into this basket. This basket here drains out. This catches the big debris, everything down to a quarter inch, and then goes down to the floor drain, which has another secondary large plastic box over it that goes to the pump intakes. In the pump intakes, we got another backup traditional pump skimmer basket. That basket will likely have nothing in it, virtually nothing in it, because it should all be trapped here. Anything small enough to get through here is going to get through that basket and go into the filter, where we get down to the fine 5-10 micron type size material. So I've had the pool full for quite some time now, and there's just nothing getting in it. I don't have traditional backyard debris like grass clippings and trees. It's so high up in the air, it's just staying really clean. So I doubt I'll get into this basket, maybe once a year, if even that. But one vault's almost done, a little more to do. We'll get back on the other vault. What you see right here is a big 3-inch pipes for the boilers. I'll show that room later. Meantime, back to work. All right, guys, a little closer every day. This is my Saturday afternoon project, so I got the whole day to work on it. We've been working on the boiler system here. It looks complex, but it's actually really simple and very redundant. I have multiple backups to everything. So this main boiler line right here comes off two 750,000 BTU boilers. And those are so that one is the primary driver and the other is the backup if 750,000 can't keep up, which is almost impossible. However, if I did turn on my hot tub, my house hot water, my pool, and I wanted all of those to heat up very, very quickly, I could end up needing all 1.5 million BTU. But primarily 750,000 is gonna do everything in my house, including my water tank. This is fresh water supply. You can see it coming over from the same boiler. This is a heat exchanger so that the boiler water can have glycol, antifreeze, and the insides of all these pipes will stay clean. And that's just a closed loop system with conditioner beads and everything inside of it. And then what we're able to do is loop this entire heating system from the boiler in a separate room upstairs, the two boilers, is always flowing. And if the house hot water needs anything, it pulls through these lines, feeds back. And all of these you see right here, this is titanium. If you were to look inside of these, you see a whole bunch of little tubes. The water, the conditioned water in the big pipes that flow through this direction, do not mix with the water that's gonna come out of these pipes and go to all the pool filters. It's a heat exchanger, liquid to liquid heat exchanger. The purpose for that, my boilers, they're really expensive. They're big boilers and I don't ever want to maintain them. A typical problem with a pool, saves a lot of money, but the water that's going through the pool boiler is the salt water or chlorinated water, depending on which system you use. And if you get your chemistry a little out, you actually destroy your whole boiler. Your boiler internals just go to junk. These boilers I have are really expensive. They're designed to be 50 plus year boilers. I've got some at my hangars. One of them has been running 15 years straight, never had a problem. And when you're running a glycol closed loop, you don't get all the calcium deposits and all the other things building up in your boiler exchanger. So that's why I've done it. This one, if it calls, will pull to melt all the snow on my pool patio so I never have to have ice out there. That's this system. This one is my hot tub, pool main one, pool super deep. So my pool has multiple zones. I'm taking advantage of the thermal climb water naturally does. I'm heating up the top area of the pool, which is about 25,000 gallons of the 5-foot level that you normally are in. And then the super deep, I'm gonna let it stay cold. There's no reason to heat that. When specifically I'm just doing free dive training and we're used to diving through thermal climbs. And so you'll feel that change from warm to cold. But I do have the option to fire it up, heat the bottom of the super deep part of the pool. I can take it from the mid 60, 70 degree water bring it up to 88, 90, 104 if I want. We can turn it into a hot tub. So I do have that option on the deep side of the pool, but I don't have to heat that all the time. So this is the system. Each one of these ins and outs will flow to each filter. So all my zones are filtered. I'll have a series of three giant filter systems for the pool. And since this is now a closed loop system, it's the same fluid always looping, we have to have an air release to let out all the little bubbles over time. And also we have to have a place that as that fluid expands and contracts, it can move inside of this with a separation unit. So this is my expansion tank for one of my zones. I have another one on that side for the house zone. And this right here is called a buffer tank, very different than the expansion tank. You can see these two pipes flow in and back out of this tank. You might think that there's a separator in there like there is in the heat exchanger to the fresh water of the house, but there's not. This is just a place for the boiler water to come in, loop this large volume, and send it back out to the boilers. So there's kind of a buffer of a big stage of a lot of energy stored. So this is a giant heat battery. And then anytime any of these zones pull, they actually, this pump only pushes and pulls from my giant battery. It's not actually having to push all the way up to the boiler. It's just going around this little teeny loop right here. The other fun thing about doing this right here, this tank, is my fresh water. As you can tell, it's a lot of fresh water. It is a heat exchanger running two loops. The fresh water side actually has a 1-inch line I have hooked it up coming out the top that loops through the entire house right to every single fixture and goes right past it to the next, to the next, to the next, and then comes back to this tank. And that is running on a Grumpa circulation pump and it never turns off. The purpose of that is, it doesn't matter how far away this tank is from the shower or the water spigot or washing your hands, there is hot water at full temp at every single fixture in my house, including the outside of my house. All my garden hoses on the outside of the house have hot and cold in case I want to wash a car in the winter, maybe melt some ice at 120 degrees. I have unlimited on-demand hot water. I can turn on every shower, every faucet, every spigot, and never have temperature fade because of the big line that's looping to this tank. And instead of just a standard little single or double or even triple hot water system in a house, this is running off the entire 1.5 million BTU system. So I can turn on every hot water fixture in my house and not ever worry about anything going down. And I'll barely be tapping the 1.5 million BTU I have available, and I can still run any of these. So everything's redundant. Everything can run simultaneously, independently, and it's extremely efficient because this big boiler system can ramp down to whatever demand is being called and ramp back up. So I'm super excited about it. It's been really fun. I got a lot to do. I've just been gluing together these bypass fittings. They're going in these walls right here. This is just part of the pool side of the plumbing. A lot of times you add certain chemicals, or if you had a water stop leaks into your water to try and solve a problem, or you're doing a heavy flush on your system and you don't want your pumps running that chemistry through your filter systems, I'm plumbing it all up so that at one turn of a valve, I can take all the water that's coming in this side to the pumps of everything, twist the valve, and send it right back out to the pool and bypass anything I might be doing with something unique with water chemistry so that that doesn't go through my heat exchangers and my big filters lining up. That's a lot of talking. I hope it makes sense. I'm having a lot of fun. You guys know the drill. Let's get back to work. Awesome. Turning up several of my pumps. See how much water I get flowing through here. They're all coming down big giant pipes there, the skimmer drain. Going through my basket. You can kind of see the water flow into my vault. And then my basket collects the big debris. and it goes out through the bottom of the vault into the pumps and then out through the filters and heaters in the other room through those outlet and return lines and then back up into the pool and hot tub.
Well, we did a string line to set the dirt from concrete to concrete. Then we ran a compactor, graded it, ran a compactor, and now we're doing a final grade. You can see way in the distance, we got pink line right there. And my son Dylan doing grout on the tile I set the other day. We got, it's hard to see. There's the string line. And it may look like it's touching the ground, but it's not. We got the exact clearance all the way out from my yard slope to the river.
All right, guys. I got these papers done last night. Finished about 3 a.m. and it was raining constantly. So my wife, Chandra, was awesome. She kept bringing out a new dry coat and would take my soaking one inside and throw it in the dryer. So I just revolved my clothes all day. It was raining all day, but this we finished last night. Now I'm setting the stairs, and I like to make sure I got a good base. So underneath here, I have a concrete bed, then compacted fill, then sand to bed this in. Now on the stairs, so many times I see paver stairs just move all over the place. So I actually like to use wall caps for stairs rather than the pavers because they're thinner and I can get a bigger top. So I'm gonna use this 20-inch cap as my step, even though I don't have a 20-inch step, I'll be able to put the caps on the step this direction, and then I'll turn another one of these sideways so I got a big 4-inch rise, and then another 4-inch cap will make a perfect 8-inch step. So you can see right now, this is really wet. And what I've done here is I've poured the concrete back, going far enough back and held it over 1/4-inch high. Now I'm gonna take glue, the bonding glue for the pavers, and I'll trowel it on like you would setting tile, so it's not just little blobs on it. I wanna actually trowel it on smooth because this is perfect level set. And I'll bed it in the glue and squish it into the concrete at the same time and then level them all together. And what's gonna happen, since I've held this concrete higher than where the paver needs to be for the step, as I push it down in and bed it and level it all out, the concrete's gonna come out from underneath it. I wanna make sure I do that because if you go the other way and start level and put into it, if it barely pushes down, the concrete sloughs and you get an air gap, water gets in that air gap and freezes, then it starts the movement on the pavers. So this is ready to go. I'm gonna glue the face, set the treads, work my way up. We'll stair step all the way up in solid concrete. And then we go back and we'll finish the paver layer on the upper level. So you guys know the drill. Today's much better. No rain, in the 40s. It's a great day. Back to work. This way, check that way. Got a partial bubble coming this direction. The face is set. Absolutely no air pockets underneath this. No place for water to go. The glue joint at the front. I'm gonna leave this for several hours. I'm gonna go do that side. I'll have to come back later when this sets up enough. I'll take another one of these stones, turn it this direction, fill it with concrete again all the way up to 1/2 inch above that one to mirror what I did here. Set the next layer of stairs going back that direction. You guys know the drill. Back to work.